report any violations of the nearest medical launcher, stadium official, or security personnel. Violations can result in ejection from the stadium and or possible arrest. We'd also like to remind you that Vanderbilt Stadium is a non-smoking venue during athletic activities within the stadium, on the concourse, or in the restrooms. Thank you for your cooperation. Ladies and gentlemen, we call your attention to midfield for the toss of the coin for tonight's game. The captains, first for our guest from Georgia, number 14, Mike Bobo, number 19, Hines Ward, number 28, Brandon Talbert, and number 45, Greg Bright. Commodore captains for 97, number 4, Corey Chavis, number 17, Damian Allen, number 39, John Bradley, number 49, Jamie Duncan, and number 89, Jay Stallworth. The joint referee, Rogers Redding, for the toss of the coin.
I didn't even see who won the toss. I didn't even see.
Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know who's going to return because the award's not starting. We don't know who's going to be returned. Might be pass.
Probably pass, I bet, yeah.
Iowa 24, Ohio State 31, Indiana nothing. Air Force 17, Fresno State 20, that's a final. Purdue a 45-20 victory over the Badgers of Wisconsin. Washington defeats Arizona 58-28. Victor over Auburn. Florida State defeats Georgia Tech today 38-0. Kansas State 36-17 over Texas A&M. It was Northwestern 19, Michigan State 17. Arizona State 31, Stanford Cardinal 14. And it was Washington State 63, California 37. In the third quarter, it's North Carolina 10, okay. North Carolina State 7. In the third quarter, UCLA 14, Oregon State 3, at the head, Tennessee 21, Alabama 6.
Back here at Vanderbilt Stadium, Nashville, Tennessee, Georgia and Vanderbilt ready to get underway. Then you get a look at Jim Dunnan in his second year as head coach of Georgia after a really successful tenure at Marshall. And for Vanderbilt, Woody Wittenhofer, the defensive architect of the Iron Curtain. They're playing Woody ball here, is what they call it. 56 degrees. Calm, clear, and cool. Excellent condition. Patrick Pass, the kicker, here at the kickoff for Vanderbilt. John Markham, and back to receive number 6, Patrick Pass for Georgia. And they're underway. It's taken by Chip Bailey. It's up across the 20. Up across the 30 and falls. Georgia will begin their first possession of the game. A 33-yard return, a great way to start, Mike.
Well, I thought he was going to break it on through. They had a nice hole right up the gut.
Now you got to look at Mike Bobo, and you talked about him in the open, just what changes he's made this season, and what is, and there are the numbers you see on him. Great game last week against Tennessee. No touchdowns, but no interceptions also, something he's really cut down on this year. Has made a big difference for this Georgia. 33. Fred Vincent with the stop.
Well, that's what you're going to see out of Georgia all night, shifting like that. And what they're doing there is the defense for Vanderbilt, that old Woody Woodenhofer defense, he likes to make the calls according to the lineup, according to the formation of the offense. So the offense will shift, and that'll force this Vanderbilt defense to change their calls.
16-yard pickup by Champ Bailey. First and 10 now. There you go. The give is the Buckets. Up across midfield, across the 45, deep into the territory for Vanderbilt. To the 44 Vanderbilt.
Georgia would like nothing better than to move it right down the field on Vanderbilt. This defense, whatever you have, great defense, and Vanderbilt does, they're going to keep them in every game. All their games have been close. This defense, were ever to slip a little bit, it could be a long night for Vanderbilt. Georgia would love to take the opening drive down on
second and two. Jamie Duncan, we talked about him earlier, and there he is, making an impact early.
Well, you know, like I said about him in the open, you won't have to worry about finding him. He's going to be in the middle of your TV screen all night. 71 tackles this year. He leads the SEC, led the SEC in tackles last year. And also the year before that, he led Vanderbilt with 120 tackles. He is all over the field. This defensive scheme, he gets protected by the defensive line. He rolls, and he just is like a heat-seeking missile.
Third and two from the 44 for Georgia. Vanderbilt Stadium in Nashville, Tennessee, for the SEC matchup tonight between the Georgia Bulldogs and the Vanderbilt Commodores. Sam Crenshaw, along with Mike Golick and John Wyatt, reporting for us from the sideline. 12, nothing to score as you look at Jim Donner in his second year as head coach of the Georgia Bulldogs. And Woody Woodenhofer, his first year on the sidelines here for Vanderbilt as head coach. He's been the defensive coordinator here. First and 10, Georgia, from the Vanderbilt 36. Mike Bobo calling the signal. Just too long for Tony Small. Let's check. Two runners now for Georgia. We see Tony Small just missed that pass. Now you see right there at the tight end, Larry Brown, a big one for the Mike.
And moonlighting as a basketball
player. On the basketball team. Here's a big guy you like here. Matt Stinchcomb, number 79 on the line. He anchors that offensive. Into the lineup now, along with Edwards, number 22, Alandis Gary in the backfield, alongside Mike Bobo. Second and 10 from the 36. The give is to Gary. On the left side, across the 35, knocked out of bounds around the 33. A tenacious Vanderbilt defense. Glenn Young with the stop there. Take a look at their lineup. And you see Stallworth, Oz, Harvey, and Young. He's been getting big things done for him this season.
Six sacks, he leads the team in that department.
Senior linebackers, Jordan Duncan Hall, all are good ones. And the secondary, Chavis, Battles, Batten, and Fred Vincent. Third and six from the 32 of Vanderbilt. You take a look at Duncan. Across the 15, down to the 12-yard line. Ashley Battles with the stop.
Makes the final stop for Vanderbilt. Bulldog first down, first and 10 for Georgia.
See the pass, 36, he's not going to go farther, 10-yard route, just come in, come underneath Fred Benson, the defensive back. Throw is on the money because Bobo has time. Nice job of running after the catch. The key there, Mike Bobo had time. We had talked to Norm Parker, defensive coordinator for Vanderbilt, yesterday, and he had said, hey, for us to get after Georgia, we have to blitz. You know, we can't do it with a four-year-old. We need to blitz and take a look at Corey Allen.
Corey Allen is a solid performer. He's kind of been in the shadows of Hines Ward. Ward not starting tonight. Could be a good night for this young man to step up.
Well, sure. You know, anytime your star goes down, other people have to pick up the slack. Corey Allen, the starter, is open. You may see a lot more passes tonight.
First and 10, number 15 of Vanderbilt. It was that man again, Mr. Duncan.
Jamie Duncan said his key. It's a swarming defense. Again, they like to protect their linebackers. They have an active defensive line. Ryan Halls, number 98, the nose tackle, only 245 pounds. But they say if there's a street fight anywhere, you want this guy leading the way because he's just a wheelhouse. He's very active. They're all very active, and they run to the ball. That's why you get that swarming effect.
Second base, the ninth play of this drive for Georgia. Looking, throwing across the middle. Great defensive stop. Anthony Jordan there with the stop. Bobo trying to hit Jermaine Wiggins, tight end.
Well, nice play by Jordan. He's got man coverage on Wiggins. Wiggins is trying to run a crossing route right over the middle of the field. You see Jordan right on him. Gets that left arm. You see the right arm. He's got the cast. That is going to be ineffective for him tonight. He's got a couple of fingers sticking out from it, but he's really not going to be effective unless, you know, he uses it as a club. Then maybe it will be effective. You saw Pittman with that left arm do a great job knocking the ball down.
9 plays, 55, yeah, 59 seconds. 3rd and 8 from the 12. Bobo looking, throwing to Edwards. Still on his feet across the 10. Let's go to the sideline and check in with John Dwyer.
Well, they went down the field without their star, Hines Ward, a guy that is nursing a left strained knee. And Coach Donnan told me just before kickoff that he would not start Hines Ward and that Hines may not play tonight. In a perfect Georgia world, against Kentucky and Florida and Auburn coming up, they'd love to get him on the bus, give him another week to rest.
Yeah, have Hines in for a 27-yard attempt. What's up? Georgia draws first blood. Vanderbilt's turn is next when we come back to Nashville.
ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by Armstrong Air. Strength you can rely on. ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by Armstrong Air. Strength you can rely on. ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by Armstrong Air.
Back at Vanderbilt Stadium in Nashville, Tennessee. Georgia leading at 3-0, 10-16 to go in the first half. The Bulldogs, Mike.
See, 11 plays, 58 yards, just against fourth-ranked defense nationally. See this about that. In that fourth different receivers he used, and their short pass, not really going to go try and go too deep tonight.
Mark Johnson is on the line.
Jimmy Williams on the return. A nice return. On the box of 23 to the 28-yard line, and that is where Vanderbilt.
Jeff Harris.
A 23-yard return by Williams, freshman from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. There you see a look at the quarterback, Damian Allen, senior from Strong. Solid game last week against Northern Illinois. He's had his problems getting the offense going this season. Let's see how he does against Georgia. First and 10. The pitch to Williams. He's sneaking at the 31-yard line. Trey Sipe with the stop. Take a look at the offensive unit now for Vanderbilt. Asma, the wide receiver. Johnson, Morgan, and Williams. You saw him already carry the ball twice in this game. Next line, Kondre Salzman, Barnett, and Ramente Bynum, the offensive front for Vanderbilt. Now take a look at the Georgia defensive unit. Snelling, Stroud, Bird, Antonio Cochran has started. And the linebackers are good ones. You see Tolbert, White, and Grant Rutters. Third and 10 from the 29. Vanderbilt. Allen looking. Rush, ball comes loose. Picked up by Butler. Touchdown, Georgia. Grant, who came in on the blitz and knocked the ball loose, and something bad happened.
They wanted to come after Vanderbilt early. They know their offense has been struggling. They want to try to get Damian Allen's face early, force him to try and make the plays. Right there, he had a chance to make the after.
Allen's on for the point after, and it's good.
Wow, I mean, this blitz came right up the gut. It's a delayed blitz. They eat up all the blockers. You see the linebacker coming late. Or in it's Grant, you see him just does a nice job, strips the ball. Allen had nowhere to go. Bailey scoops it up and scores. And they're going to blitz Damian Allen. They want to try it in four plays. This is something that Vanderbilt can't get into the habit of, running two plays and then passing on the third.
Woody Woodenhopper not happy with that at all. Can't be. Not the kind of start he wanted against this Georgia football team. There you see the difference with Georgia. Capitalizing on
it. It's a huge field position, time of possession. It changes so many things. It's kind of a domino effect when you get the turnover ratio in your favor. And Vanderbilt can ill afford to fall behind like this. They do not have the type of offense that can bring a team back. You know, give it a lot of time, not even quickly, but give it on a gang attack. Not a great nickel package. You know, they have a hard time doing this. If they've got it. The defense, again, they're going to have to rely on the defense.
Up across the 15 to the 20, and driven out of bounds around the 26-yard line. ESPN BN2's college football coverage continues next Saturday at 12:30, when Ron Dane leads the number 24 Badgers into a Big Ten showdown against the Minnesota Gophers. Watch all the action on ESPN2, your home for college football.
Well, Vanderbilt's got to mix this up a little bit. They can't just run, pass. They have to get a little creative in their play calling, Sam.
Look at this. This is what has really hurt this Vanderbilt offense this season, the fumbles, as they go first and 10 from their own 27. The game is the game. And he struggles. Let's go to the studio and check in with Mike Adamley. All right, yet another game that folks in this part of the Tennessee Vols. Second and eight for Vanderbilt. Allen gets the throw.
and it's complete. All across from the tight end up to midfield.
Kirby Smart in on the stop for Georgia. Mike talked about the passes they wanted to set up for Damian Allen to get some confidence.
Well, this is what they need to do. This is off of play action. You're going to see him run a lot of bootleg off of faking the handoff. They're going to try and get Damian Allen out on the corner. Did you see the fake there? Now he's by himself, not a lot of pressure. He's rolling the way he throws. A nice throw to Carson. He's going to kind of misdirection plays this offense needs.
Champ Bailey there with the stop for Georgia.
Well, what makes the outside running tough for Vanderbilt is they've run a couple of different types of offense over the years, from straight drop back passing to option. And we have option runners. Your wide receiver is not really used to being pass catchers, and now you're asking to block a little more. And right now Georgia's just bringing up too many people on the outside.
Second and eight from the 48 of Georgia.
Nice play by Sight. Had a man-to-man. They're going to put man-to-man coverage on these backs. Williams, a true freshman coming out of the backfield. They like this kid. Sight does a nice job keeping him in his sights, breaking down, forcing Williams one way or the other, not giving him both ways. Did a great job. Picture book tackle there.
Second and 14. Tavares Huggins in the line. He's good by the left of the road. Right through the hands of Todd Yoder.
And he had Yoder. He had him. You know, this has been a problem for Damian Allen, his accuracy. You know, he was scrambling a little bit, but again, he was running the way he was throwing. It's a lot easier for quarterback to roll the way he's going to throw. He had Yoder wide open over the middle. If he'd have caught that, made the completion, that would have been a first down.
Joe Webb is on the punt. A freshman from averaging 40.1 a punt. Gets a good bounce down to the 12, and that's where Georgia will start when we come back to Nashville.
Can't really say a receiver because Vogel's throwing to four different ones. Probably, if he's passing, let's get a look at the time he has, because right now Vanderbilt's not blitzing and they're not getting any pressure on him at all. And what they're doing too is they're running these quick side patterns, and they're using, what they do is they bring out the offensive lineman to come in and pick the people who are in man coverage. They did it a couple of times. Kind of tough to see, but they happen on the quick pass. You've had them on the replay, so they're right there. I'm going to explain them better when they happen.
Fish. That's something fish is at. Back in Nashville, Tennessee, Sam Crenshaw along with Mike Golick and John Dwyer. Georgia with a 10-0 lead over the Vanderbilt Commodores. And on their first drive, Mike, they went 11 plays all the way down the field. Think they can put together another drive this time.
Well, even though it's early in the game, this is a big series for the Vanderbilt defense. You know, they let Georgia drive down the first time. Then Georgia gets the turnover for the score. Vandy's got to put together a good defensive stand here deep in the territory. Then they can get some decent field position coming back.
First and 10 from our own 12. Across the 10, across the 20. Up to about the 24-yard line. Great balance.
One of the swarming defense, you're going to see it right here. A lot of times it opens up that cutback lane. When you swarm, when you have an aggressive defense, everybody's flying to the ball. A lot of times they're flying too fast. They'll lose sight of their responsibility, try and get to the ball carrier, and he gets cut back against the grain. So even though you want to swarm and you want to be very active, you still have to hold on to your responsibilities just for that reason right there.
Ansley Battle's got a hand on him. He was able to bring him down. First and 10 for the old 23. Back to Edwards. Across the 25, up to about the 28. Got a penalty flag on the play. Alfonso Harvey and Carlton Hall in on the stop, and that one's coming back.
But you see the type of play calling Georgia wants to do now. These are short passes. And what they do is they go to the short pass and look at the lineman, the offensive lineman, the left guard tackle, go out to the left of your screen, and they're going to try and pick off the people coming up for the tackles. That's what they want to do. Quick passes, let the lineman get out in front, put their big bodies on the smaller bodies, and then the receivers will cut back against it.
Look at this stat, and that's been one of the keys to Georgia's success this season as well, by one of the least penalized teams, the least penalized team in the conference.
They've only been penalized 15 times. This was their 16th coming in. That's great discipline, and that starts with the head coach right there, Jim Donovan.
Michael Greer in the lineup now for Georgia. First and 22 from their own 11. Across the 20. Not down around the 28 yard line. Corey Chavis, the senior from Aiken, South Carolina, wants a fumble call.
Now he's making his bid. Georgia having a lot of success running the ball right now. And why they are, Sam, is because they're getting big bodies on the linebackers. We talked about early in the game how the linebackers like the flow. You see 49, he just went out of your screen, but a big body's going to get on him. And he's getting blocked. He has a hard time when the big bodies get on him. He has a tough time cutting and getting away from it to make the play. And right now, Georgia very successful getting out on the linebackers. You look at defensive coordinator Norm Clark behind the referee there.
Second and four from the 29. Again, it's McGarry. Shakes off the first tackle and gets across the 30. Raheem Rock Batten with the stop.
Well, this time they brought a little bit of pressure. It was a run blitz. You see the linebackers up there blitzing. They're hitting gaps. Got to make the tackle, though. They missed the tackle tonight. There, Lamont Turner missed one. That's another reason they're so successful. They know when to shoot those gaps right there. They had a run blitz out. They just got to hope Jordan doesn't check to a pass in those situations.
Third and three, the Bulldogs have both tight ends now. And he's got the first down. Correction, that was to Tony Spall. Number nine, he picks up the first down for Georgia.
Corey Chavis on the tackle, but what Mike Bobo saw is Corey Chavis was backed off. He was about 8 yards off on a third and three. You can't be that far off on a third and three. Bobo knows that, does the fake and gets it to him. You see Chavis coming up late, does a nice job on the tackle, but it's third and three. He needs to get up there quicker or play a little tighter.
Look at the total yards so far. 93 for Georgia, only two for Vanderbilt. As Georgia goes first and 10. Go down the pass to the tight end, Larry Brown. Stopped by Anthony Jordan. And he's up around first down yardage.
Anthony Jordan got caught no man's land. The quarterback, he starts to come up. And then the pass goes right over his head. You see Jordan turn around and then go after the tight end. He's got the tight end in coverage, but he sees the rolling quarterback starts to come up to contain. And then all of a sudden that pass goes over his head, and he's like, well, uh-oh, got to get back.
That's the first down. Georgia.
For Georgia. Well, Georgia's making it up and up tonight. The running game is going very well. That obviously sets up the pass. Again, you see the first down, 6-1 in favor of Georgia. And the big thing again, Bobo, the short passing game. That's why his efficiency is so high. His completion percentage is so high. They're short passes. Nothing crazy yet. But right now, they don't really need to go downfield.
It's that passing that has really set up the running game. Let's see if that comes into play now.
Again.
Up the
time, the linemen are getting on the linebackers. That time, the center, Brad Stafford, 283-pound senior, came out and got on Jamie Duncan. He got on Duncan just 6'1", goes 230. His big bodies are getting out. He has a tough time getting off him. He really needs to throw behind the line. That time, Stafford, a nice job getting in front of him. And he doesn't really have to block him. He just has to shield him in the back of the cut behind him.
Second and four from midfield. Change again. Carlton Hall in on the stop, one of the finest senior linebackers for Vanderbilt.
Carlton Hall, you know, he kind of gets lost in the Jamie Duncan fanfare. Carlton Hall is ranked second in the SEC. He has 65 tackles. He's right behind Jamie Duncan. So between the two of them, they're the top two tacklers in the SEC this year. He kind of gets lost in the shuffle with Jamie Duncan.
89, Wiggins comes back in for Georgia. Edwards comes out. And 25, Ronnie Bradley into the lineup for the Bulldogs on third and one. The give is to Selma Calloway and Jamie Duncan in on the stop. It's a first down for Georgia. They keep the sticks moving.
You know, Vanderbilt's given up 98 yards on the ground this year. One of the reasons they rank so high defensively. Georgia really doing a nice job of putting bodies on bodies. Something Vanderbilt's got to do a little better of a job. The inside guys, Alfonso Harvey and Ryan Hall, the inside guys, especially the guy on the nose. You see, he's tilted. That means he's got to try and eat up the center and the guard to keep the linebacker free. So far, it's not been working.
First and 10 from the 43 of Vanderbilt. Complete to Tony Small. Up across the 40, around the 41. Let's check in with Mike Adamley. Back here at Nashville, it's 10-0 Georgia. The lead over Vanderbilt. You hear the numbers from Bobo early on.
7-9 for 6 again, moving around. Got 5 different receivers going.
Champ Bailey split wide left. There's a whistle and a timeout. In the first quarter, we've completed one quarter from Vanderbilt Stadium in Nashville. Georgia leads 10-0 over Vanderbilt. We'll be right back.
Alfonso Harvey?
What's this?
Oh, well, Smith that he came in for, yeah. Okay. Hey, yeah, my fault. I'm glad you told me that. I guess I'm just trying to get too much in, you know? Okay. All right. We're on camera. You gotta hop down there. We're on camera. Go down there. We're going on camera. You want the light on up here or no? Yeah, put a light on. Go ahead. Yeah. Hey, if we're coming back, a graphic you might want to throw up. 5 different receivers that have caught balls for Georgia. Might be a graphic you can get it up down the road.
How about Bobo and the mix? You want to talk about him? The different
receivers? Bobo, 7-9, 63 yards.
And different receivers.
5 different receivers. I'll just throw the stat out now. We can get the receivers later. Which camera?
Okay, all right. Hi. Tennessee, Vanderbilt, and Georgia. Georgia with a 10-0 lead. Mike, what are your thoughts on what you've seen from Bobo so far?
Well, the big thing about Mike Bobo is his ability to spread the ball around. He's 7-9 for 63 yards. Again, all short patterns. You know, not a ton of yardage right now, but he's used five different receivers. They're going to the outside. They're going to the inside, right in front of the line. Our linebackers right on the line of scrimmage. They're really, really spreading the ball around.
As we start the second quarter, Georgia 2nd-and-6 from the Vanderbilt 39.
And a good audible by Mike Bobo. He saw the middle blitz coming. He saw Jamie Duncan coming inside, so he said, let's go to a wide play. But again, Carlton Hall, the almost a forgotten man on the outside, shows great speed. It's a 228-pounder. Great speed running it down from sideline to sideline. Bobo has changed the play a number of times out here, and most of the time it's worked. This is one of the few times Vanderbilt was able to make up for it. That's a nice third down conversion rate right there. They've been about 50% all year.
2nd-and-6. The throw tipped. Ball knocked away. Getting the 34. Carlton Hall, he's having quite a game so far.
Yeah, he was just playing zone right in the middle of the field. And what he does, he looks at the quarterback's eyes and see where he's going to throw. Bobo thinks he's getting it over the top of him. Carlton Hall shows his athletic ability. He knows he's there. He just thinks he's going over the top of him. But Hall does a nice job of getting out and blocking it. A good stop for Vanderbilt.
That was third down. Now it's 4th-and-10. Dax Langley in for the kick and back to receive. Number 24, Alvin Duke. That was going to go through the end zone. 42-yard kick for Langley. And this crowd's trying to get some excitement for the Vanderbilt updates. Georgia up 10-0 on Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt's ball will come back to Nashville.
Do you want one?
Yeah.
Or no? Do you want one? I got I got to believe that Vanderbilt's going to start to throw the ball a little bit here. If that one you want to put some ISOs on the quarterback or the wide receivers. Okay. Start mixing it up with this is not a conventional run pass offense. He's got to mix up the plays.
First and 10 from their own 20. Daniel Allen. Zipping the throw. That time. And that is receiver. Complete the huddles. Knocked out of bounds at the Georgia 40.
Champ Bailey on the stop, up 37-9. Mike Mitchell was on the finish. But what a key thing right here at the time. Look at all the time he's got. Nobody even near him. Hogan came from all the way on the other side of the field. Champ Bailey, a good 5 yards behind him. Safety nowhere to be found. You see Kirby Smart coming in late. The key here again, a lot of time. Hogan from the other side of the field gets a huge jump on Champ Bailey, makes the big, big play.
First and 10 from the Georgia 43. Let's go downstairs to John Dwyer.
When I asked people from the Vanderbilt community who's the fastest player on the team, it was number 7, Tavares Hogans, although Corey Chavis may have an argument there. But you're right, to score for Vanderbilt, they're not going to grind it out, guys. You're not going to see a 10-play drive. They need a 4 or 5-play drive. Look for 7 to be more part of this offense here in the second quarter.
Thanks, John. That's an excellent point.
Tell you who else had a big part in that play was Paul Snellings. Bright did the fill, but Snellings, the defensive end, strung the play out. When you throw a sweep like that, you want to get to the corner fast. You want to start running north and south. Snellings did a great job of riding the offensive tackle out, making a running back from east and west. And then Brett Brett said, thank you very much. I'll take that over from here.
Bailey in on the stop.
That was a nice play by Bailey because he had big old Will Jacobs, 304-pounder on it. Jacobs did a good job of getting out in front of the pass. Ronald Bailey, 187 pounds, took him on, went around him, and made the play. Now, here's an interesting call. 4th down and 4, you're down 10-0. You're 0-3 in the conference. I think you got to take a few chances, and right here is a place I think I would take a chance.
Joe Webb in for the
Smart back single safety for Georgia.
Kick
into the end zone for a touchback.
Couldn't have done any better than he went down there and placed it down there. That is bad part on the coverage team. Webb did a great job. Coverage team couldn't get down there and make the play.
George will have the ball when we come back to Nashville.
It's a mistake. That's huge. If you want to show that again, you can. I mean, that was awful.
That's a great opportunity.
Oh, the point was, I mean, the ball was so high in the air, the coverage team, they were all down there. They were just in horrible position. They were either in front of the ball or not even near it. Nobody got behind the ball for it to bounce to them, and they were down there in plenty of time to do it. I mean, that, you know, when a team is 3-3, man, you got to go ahead. Yeah, go ahead. No, I didn't see. Okay. Yeah, that's good. That's good. That's good.
And receive one complimentary Sunday brunch with the purchase of another. The National Country Club.
ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by Ford Motor Company, where quality is job one, and by Joe Ball, the hottest game on earth. It's en fuego.
Back here at Vanderbilt, and Mike, you talked about the missed opportunity there by Vanderbilt and the special teams.
Well, I tell you what, they should have downed this ball. You've got to be behind the ball. You see there in front of it, and then Matt Stewart, the freshman, should have, you've got to look for the ball in the air as you're running down. A big mistake by the coach.
Special teams coach hate that kind of stuff. Mike Bobo to throw, and he's got Tony Smart. Knocked out. by Ainsley Battles.
Ainsley Battles.
23-yard pickup for Georgia.
And here's what happens when you dig them with the short routes, it opens up the longer routes again. The key here is time. Just a four-man rush by Vanderbilt. Not really good enough to get a lot of pressure with a four-man rush. Bobo able to stand back there. Nice job of the crossing route by Tony Small. And that's what happens. As you complete the shorter ones, then you start to go downfield a little more, and it'll set up a longer vertical game.
The Pines won, not starting with Small, now 4 receptions, 38 yards. First to 10, the 43.
Edwards on the carry.
Let's check in with Mike Adamlock. Tennessee looking to be in charge in that game. Second and seven from their own 46 goes Georgia. Bobo looks. Got the completion. That's his tight end, Harry Brown. Knocked out of bounds by Duncan and Hall.
Duncan and Hall, knock him out of bounds.
Again, he's got time to throw. Duncan's got the coverage. It's very tough to ask a defender to stay with a wide receiver for that long a time. You saw the receiver go by him, Larry Brown, who doubles on the court as a forward for the Georgia basketball. I don't know which one, what's he moonlighting from? Is he moonlighting from basketball to play football, or football to play basketball?
Well, there's the first day of practice, so obviously. First and 10 from the 40. Emily Bush.
Champ Bailey on the carry.
Champ Bailey on the carry. Jay Stallworth, Corey Chavis in on the stop for Vanderbilt.
Well, you notice you just said on the offense, Champ Bailey. He's also the cornerback going both ways. He did it in the opening game against Arkansas State, the first player at Georgia since 1991 to do that. You'll see him get a few carries at wide receiver as well as cornerback. And then you also saw Corey Chavis on the tackle for Vanderbilt. Keep an eye on that guy. He's a guy that'll play on Sundays next year.
Second and six. Up around the 30, should be close to the first down. Tune in tomorrow at 4 o'clock as ESPN brings you coverage of the NASCAR Busch Series. Kenwood 300 from Fontana, California. Defending Busch Series champion Randy LaJoie is currently riding high in first place in the standings. Race coverage begins at 4 o'clock tomorrow on ESPN.
Georgia, good job on that last play, picking up the blitz. They know they have a hot receiver. Bobo, again, poised in that pocket, getting the ball out.
Champ Bailey still in on offense. It's big wide right. First and 10. The 29 of Vanderbilt. Bobo looks to release.
Bobo pass and hitting for Small, incomplete.
Trying to get to Tony Small there on defense. Corey Chavis. He just called his name a little while ago.
Well, I think defensive coordinator Norm Parker saying, "Okay, enough of this. I'm bringing my horses after you." They blitzed two plays in a row now. They're going to come after Mike Bobo. Make him make the quick decisions that takes away him sitting in the pocket and being able to pick a receiver out. Now Vanderbilt is trying to force the issue. They're going to try and make Bobo pick one guy because they're bringing a lot of pressure.
Second and 10 from the 29. Gets it away, and he had to get rid of it because Corey Chavis on defense, but Carlton Hall is coming in a hurry.
Well, three plays, three blitzes, and a welcome to Vanderbilt by Carlton Hall, the one Mike Bobo. That's what you call hitting them and planting them. That's what you want to do. You want to hit a guy, and you want to, you know, let's be honest, you want to land on him when you hit him, and he does. He hits him, he lands on him, he drives through him. That's the way you got to tackle a quarterback. You see Chavis with the great coverage. What they're doing is they're taking away all the options that Mike Bobo has. And he is nicked up, and he's coming to the sidelines. Vanderbilt saying, hey, let's take away their options and make them throw to one man.
We're taking a break, and we'll be back with more from Nashville. Georgia leads it 10-0.
Bowling Green Hills wishes the Commodores good luck.
Am I saying too much still, or? All right. Oh, okay. All right.
Thank you. I can tell you this. Jag off.
I would be drawing a line right here.
Got a great looking moon there tonight. Look at that.
Boy, that is nice.
That's beautiful. Isn't that nice?
Wow. That's very nice.
Moon over the Music City.
They're bringing one more person than Georgia has to block. Five offensive linemen. Vanderbilt brings six.
Now you see third down conversions as Georgia tries to convert another. The pass, great catch. Tom Smart. But Bobo takes another lick.
And what this does, it puts pressure on the cornerbacks. When you're going to blitz, the cornerbacks have got to come through. The cornerbacks in safety, they're going to be manned up, and they've got to stay close. Bobo is taking a beating, and this may have an effect later in the game if Vanderbilt can keep it close. But right now, they brought that blitz, Sam, from the outside. They're much more effective when they bring the blitz up the middle. Coming from the outside, it takes a little longer to get there. Up the middle, where Bobo stays a little quicker.
Small count, six receptions, 63 yards. First and 10 on the Friday 11 of Vanderbilt. Corey Chavis covering.
I've seen a little bit of an effect on Mike Bobo here. Kind of backing out when he threw that ball. Kind of backing up off his heels a little bit. He's been hit hard twice now from the blitz. Vanderbilt blitzing about four plays in a row now. That was a quick pass, but he's kind of getting out of there. He's feeling the heat a little bit, and he's backing out. You see, he knows that pressure's coming. He's just back, just a little bit. Tough to really tell, but just enough now where I think he sees that rush and feels that rush a little more.
Second and 10 from the 11. You can see their numbers inside the red zone. Bobo keeps up across the 10, inside the 10 to about the 8. Jamie Duncan there for the stop.
I'll tell you what, if I were him, I would be looking over at Jim Donnan, the head coach. He's also the offensive coordinator, saying, you know, coach, I just got decked twice. Now you're calling an option? You want me to run the ball? There's Jamie Duncan looking me right in the face. I don't know about that. Jim Donnan saying, I know you're tough, son. Get out there and run the option.
Big play here for Georgia and for Vanderbilt. They can hold. Third and 8. 10 plays, 71 yards. 4 minutes this drive for Georgia. To talk about it. Got a timeout, and we'll come back and see what Georgia does on 3rd and 8 when we return to Nashville.
This been a 10 play 71 so far. Oh, I'm sorry. Was I on?
First drive, 11 minutes. Second drive, 11 minutes. a little joint just down the road.
Let's just cheer like this. Yeah, it's so high, and then all you see is like my butt.
The Vanderbilt Post.
American Airlines and Vanderbilt Travel bring you a magnificent week or two in Hawaii. One lucky Commodore plane and guests will fly round trip to Hawaii, courtesy of American Airlines. Just spend a week in Hawaii, accommodations
for the city of Vanderbilt. Yes, yes,
Andy! Yes!
Yes, Andy! Yes! Yes, Andy! Yes! Yes, Andy! Yes, we done!
Drop him down if you want. Do whatever you want.
You
got like 20 seconds. 20 seconds.
Get Vandy on!
Eight, seven, six, five, four.
Welcome back to Nashville. Sam Crenshaw along with Mike Rowan and John Dwyer. There you see the head men for these two teams, Woody Wittenhofer on the left and Jim Dunnan on the right for Georgia.
And this drive has been 10 points and 71 yards. Georgia has never had a drive of over 70 yards against the Woody Wittenhofer defense. Here's the first one right here to continue.
Big play for Sandy. 38. Bobo just got rid of it. Jamie Duncan in on the play again, and a big stop for Vanderbilt.
Yeah, it really was. Again, another big drive they gave up, though. I'm sure they're not going to be very happy about that. Again, the inside blitz is working. Jamie Duncan coming right up the gut. And you know Bobo's been hit a couple times. He feels it. He's throwing off his heels now. Back it up, throwing the ball. He saw running back Robert Edwards, 47, trying to get over. He didn't pick up the blitz in time, but this series, even though Jordan Lewis was has had the thought that he went
and it's good.
Three more for Georgia. 13-0 the score. Georgia with the lead over Vanderbilt.
Again, that's the first time a Georgia team playing against Woody Wittenhofer as defensive coordinator at Vanderbilt and head coach has had a drive of over 70 yards. Georgia's had a couple of nice drives tonight. One 11 play, this one another 11 play. You look at this field goal, it actually hit the goal post.
Nap Hines.
caught that flag that you can tell the wind by.
Yeah.
I like the kickers for Georgia, Hap and Dax.
And Dax.
Hap and Dax the punter and Hap Hines the place kicker. It's
nice day.
Where they got those from.
Nice days to play on. So Vanderbilt gets set to go to work on offense again. With 7:19 remaining.
Mark Johnson set to kick off for the Georgia Bulldogs. Back to the
receiver. It's taken by Upton.
On the return. Takes it out to his own 22-yard line. It'll be first and 10 for the Commodores.
ESPN continues its coverage next Saturday at 12:30. Wolverines hook up with the 11th-ranked Spartans for an in-state Big Ten battle. Then, at 7 o'clock, there's more football. Third-ranked Seminoles try to stay undefeated when they meet the Cavaliers in an ACC showdown. Watch all the action next week on ESPN. Now you can see who's been controlling the clock and the ball in this game. But a big pickup on the first down and a good start to this drive.
Well, that's the exact same play they ran last time to Hogan's. Exact play fake. Hogan's come all the way across the field. Good play call. Hey, if they don't stop it once, keep running again. Vanderbilt has to keep doing this. They have to keep mixing up the plays and establish some kind of running game, which will help their passing game.
First and 10 from their own 36. Maybe picks up a yard. Marlis Leroy in on the stop for Georgia.
Right now, the defensive line for Georgia really doing a nice job. If they're not making the tackles, they're forcing the running backs wide. Again, Vanderbilt never really having a chance to turn up the field. They've got to get some plays, run some plays. This is only their 14th play of the game. They've only been averaging 59 plays. That's a tough burden on your defense.
With a stop, but they're inside Georgia territory.
When we talked about Damian Allen, he's been a option quarterback. He's been a seven-step drop quarterback. Now he's a movable pocket quarterback. He rarely stands in the pocket. He's always rolling one way or the other. A nice job getting Carson out free, but credit some Damian Allen on this one. There's a lot of pressure coming at him. He does a nice job freeing himself to the outside. That's a strong one. He's a little bit making a great tackle behind the line and look for the receivers.
First and 10 from the Georgia 25. That was an 18-yard pickup. Allen looking. Now running up across the 45. At the 40. Still on his feet. Back to the Georgia 37-yard line goes Damian Allen. Stopped by Adrian Hollinshed.
And there's nothing wrong with having Damian Allen run the ball. Now the Georgia defense knows he could be a threat. What that play was, it was the same play to Hogan's that we've seen, except from the other side. Hogan's lineup on the other side, they play action. They tried to drag Hogan's across the field. You see seven crossing your screen. It's the same play the other way. This time Georgia's back in the cover one, a deep zone, cover two, in a deep zone, just laying back, so Allen has to run. Good job though, pulling the ball down and get some yards.
Second and two from the 37 of Georgia. The pitch is to Williams. He's up across the 40. He's got the first down. Across the 35, about the 34-yard line of Georgia.
Good job by Brian Gruber, number 64. The redshirt freshman, 298. Ponder, he does a good job of clearing out.
Greg Brighton on the stop for Georgia on that play. It'll be first and 10, Vanderbilt from the Georgia 34.
Well, this is kind of having a dual effect. Obviously, they're putting themselves in position to score, but they're also giving their defense a break.
Let's check in with John Dwyer on the sideline.
Sam and Mike, this drive is a victory into itself for Vanderbilt. Last year in Athens, an ugly 13-2 loss. Vanderbilt Commodores offense crossed midfield just twice. So things are looking good for Vandy.
Thanks, John. And Ed Lambert has been free so far. Allen with the pass. In and out. Through the hands of Zach Winkler.
This is a pass you got to hang on to when your offense is struggling. You got to make the plays. The pass is a little high. And Damian Allen has a strong arm, and he puts a lot of juice on it, sometimes too much juice. But still, whenever it hits a receiver in the hand, he's got to hang on.
And maybe that juice is a little bit of confidence that he's gaining with this guy. Third and 7 from the 31 of Georgia. Big play for the Commodores. Give us to the first man. That's going to bring on fourth down.
Well, they thought they saw something there audible to a quick hitter up the middle. Good idea, except he trips over the center, Jeff Barnett. He had some room there. Would have got the first down, but trips over his own man.
John Markham, a freshman in Greenville, Tennessee, for a 47-yard return. On the way. The drive comes up empty for the Commodores.
Georgia 13.
We got 3:09 left in the first half. Georgia leads it 13-0. We'll be right back to Nashville. Oh,
I'd say, well, Georgia's probably going to throw a little bit. So my soul, we can think about it. Even though Jamie Duncan, they're really getting some linemen on him. It was nice to him seeing the linemen getting on him. Their offensive line is really blocking well, Georgia is. Yeah, there you go. And let's keep an eye on Bobo because he's definitely not throwing like he was. You know, he's bailing a little bit. But yeah, Stinchcomb might be time to work that in. I think Vandy should have gone for that one too.
Sooner or later they're gonna have to.
Yeah, I don't know why they're Well, trying to fool him. They checked to it. He thought he saw something to have the middle open. And he might have gotten the first down, but it was so clogging there.
It's your chance to ask the coaches the questions you want answered. Every Wednesday, before a football game in the faculty dining room in Grand Hall from 12:15 to 12:45.
Back at Vanderbilt Stadium, Nashville, Tennessee, 3:09 remaining in the first half. Georgia with a 13-0 lead. They have the ball now, first and 10 from their own 30.
Big block by number 79, Max Stinchcomb. Just pushing down, Does a nice job driving him down the field. Driving Alfonso Harvey, and he's got him 7 yards down the field. Stinchcomb, a preseason All-American pick, 6'6", 280, also 3.9.
That's something.
GPA.
Yes.
Not only big and strong, but smart.
And really active in the community, involved with some mentoring programs there around the Athens, Georgia area. As Georgia now goes to work first and 10. Their own 46 to get the pass around the left side. Gets out of bounds around the 47.
Pass on the carry.
Flag. Fred Vincent in on the stop.
Flag on the play.
Yeah, they're going to get a late hit here. It's a little bit of frustration that Georgia's been successful on the ground through a Vanderbilt defense that has really kind of had its way throughout the year, even though the record is 3-3. The Vandy defense has been playing well. You get some frustration on the sideline, but that's going to cost them.
Our referee tonight is Rogers Redding.
Dead ball, personal foul against the defense, hitting the runner out of bounds, 15-yard penalty from the succeeding spot, automatic first down.
And there was no need for this. He was way out of bounds. You see him, he's slowing up and stopping. And Ryan Alls comes in and gets him the 245-pound redshirt freshman. That's a bad mistake. That'll cost you. When you need to stop a team and get the ball back, you can't be giving them freebies like that.
Not at all. Not the way Georgia's been moving tonight. It's first and 10 for them now on the Vanderbilt 38. 2:54 remaining in the first half.
Fred Vincent, number one, with the hold. Receiver was breaking out, and Vincent ended up on the ground. I think he tried to grab him as he was going outside.
Let's check in with Mike Adamway in the studio. Thanks a lot, Mike. Indeed, a day of close calls for a lot of the nationally ranked teams today.
You know, Vanderbilt is third in the conference in penalties. They only had 36 coming in tonight. They're behind Mississippi and Georgia, but a couple there have hurt.
And they have Georgia in scoring position here with just 2:46 to go in the half. First and 10 from the 28 of Vanderbilt. Bobo's going to go shotgun.
And you're going to see a blitz here.
The senior knocked down by Corey Chavis in on the stop for Vanderbilt.
this is where a defense needs to work in unison. Talking to the defensive coordinator, Norm Parker said, anytime there are no running backs in the backfield, we're going to blitz. When that happens, the corners have to notice that. They know they're in a man coverage. They've got to step up. Expect the quick pass because there's a blitz and Bobo's going to have to get the ball out of there. They need to come up a little quicker.
Georgia's second and seven. Got both tight ends in the set. Bobo gets rid of it and takes another shot. Anthony Jordan.
Again, what they're doing is they're blitzing guys right next to each other. So the lineman who has to pick it up can only pick up one of them. It's going to come from the left of your screen. See, they try and pick up Duncan, is what Robert Edwards tries to do, and Jordan goes by. That's a tough call for Robert Edwards to try and pick up one or the other. Vanderbilt now is bringing one more person than Georgia has to block.
Michael Greer back in the lineup for Georgia. He's split wide right. Third and seven from the 25 of Vanderbilt. Six more for the Bulldogs.
Well, nothing like having perfect coverage. And you know, how many times do you see this? Great coverage and the ball's actually underthrown. See, Chavis actually goes by the receiver. The ball's a little bit underthrown. And give a lot of credit to Michael Greer. He gets up and gets the ball at its highest point before Chavis has a chance at it. Big problem here is Vandy Blitzen didn't get any pressure. Gave Bobo time.
Hines extra point attempt. It's good. 2 minutes remaining in the half. Georgia now up 20-0 on Vanderbilt.
Well, you know, it's all going right when your extra point attempt gets blocked and falls over the crossbar. That one got hit and still managed to go through. It's all working for the Bulldogs tonight.
You got to look there at Michael Greer, 36. He's a legacy here at Georgia. His father played football at the University of Georgia. He's All-American. Steve Greer in the late 60s, defensive lineman. You know, Pop's got to be proud. His son pulls in the catch. You said that yourself. You like your kids to go to Notre Dame.
Absolutely. Yeah, they've got all kind of Notre Dame stuff in their room. Except I won't show them what happened today against USC.
I wasn't going to bring that up. I was going to let you bring that up.
You see Michael Greer from Athens, Georgia. 54 players out of 72 on this roster that are from Georgia. You see another drive by Georgia. That one goes 70 yards also. So again, they hadn't done that to a Vanderbilt defense in a couple of years. Put together 70-yard drive. Now they have two in just this game alone.
Got McGrath and Duke back to receive his kick. Tirico and company Monday evening at 7:30 on ESPN for NFL Prime Monday. Get 90 minutes of pregame analysis and features leading up to Monday night's matchup. Then at 9 o'clock, it's Frank Van and Al. They travel to Indy and the Colts play host to AFC Central rival Buffalo on this week's edition of Monday Night Football on ABC. And some thoughts on that game coming up Monday night, Colts and Bills.
Yeah, going back to that Monday nighter, Colts and Bills, the first time they met, Indy up 26-0, ended up losing 37-35. They're still trying to get off the schneid.
They are having a tough time this season.
Vanderbilt in the hurry-up offense, they're going to give away this underneath stuff. They're going to let Vandy get it a few yards at a time. They just don't want to get hit by a big play.
Georgia making some personnel changes on defense.
Vandy's got to get a play out of that. At least just get the
two-minute
man on the field.
Jared McGrath, Jimmy Williams,
Jeff Harris makes the tackle.
True freshman. Here's to see the timeouts. Vanderbilt does have all three, so they've got plenty of time with 1:09 to go. The clock will start to run on the referee's whistle. They've got time. Three timeouts in 1 minute is plenty of time.
They call McGrath and Williams thunder and lightning. In and out of the hands of Osmond, and he took a shot. Larry Mann in on the play, number one for Georgia.
Yeah, Larry Mann and Kirby Smart are just kind of hanging back, especially Smart. He's playing center field. He's just trying to time this hit to separate the receiver and the ball. Does a nice job. He couldn't throw it by Damian Allen, who's had some problems with his accuracy. That one was there, but receiver Asma getting sandwiched like that, very tough to hang on to the ball.
Second and 10 from their own 45, 57 seconds to go in the half. Allen looking, thinks about running it, then throws.
David Allen's pass intended for Asma, incomplete.
By Jeff Harris.
Jeff Harris breaks it
Damian
up for
Allen's
Georgia.
He's got to be smarter. He doesn't need to do that. He still has, with three timeouts, he's got time. Run the ball. You've got three timeouts. There's a lot of room there. Before they let the pressure come up, he had a chance to run. And he's just throwing the ball up like a punt. With three timeouts, a lot of time on your hands. He doesn't need to try and make that big play all in one shot, especially when they have people just sitting back in center field.
And it's fourth down.
And that's the play you have to have. When you're down 20-0, we talked about it before. We see a couple other drops by the receivers. A nice route again. Georgia playing off. Good route by Hogan. Break it in behind the linebackers and in front of the center fielders. Got to make that play.
Now Joe Webb in for the punt. Michael Greer back around his own 15 to receive.
This is interesting. The snapper, the up back, and the punter, all true freshmen.
Here comes the fair catch. He makes it at his own 24. With 32 seconds remaining before halftime. 31-yard kick by Joe Webb.
Well, game plan in the second half for Woody Woodenhofer and Vanderbilt. It's going to kind of go off the window a little bit. They can't really use a lot of the play action and the runs that they wanted to because Georgia's defense won't be fooled by it because they have to throw the ball to get back. They're going to have to maybe pull out a few trick plays. Georgia doing a great job of play calling, mixing it up, controlling the clock. They try and play here just to see where they get.
Bobo dropping back. He takes a hit, but he gets it away. Complete the pass. He's still on his feet. Across the 40. Knocked out of bounds inside Vanderbilt territory. Fred Vincent there to chase him out.
What a smart play call. You try a little. This is just a middle screen. You're throwing a quick pass to the wide receiver. Look at the defense, the offensive line. They're going to let the D-line go. They just let him go.
Look at Jason Hill.
And Mike Popo
with the hit.
Is the recipient of that hit. And they just make the pass, but, you know, they sacrifice that hit. They see how far this play gets them, then they decide if they want to keep going. Got him a lot of yards. Now they may try for another one, get field goal range.
19 seconds left in the half. Vanderbilt bitch calling for grounding.
Well, I'll tell you what,
no receiver there.
There wasn't a receiver anywhere near it. I think they have a little reason to complain there. Georgia has a timeout left. The thing they probably want to do is Vanderbilt's going to cover the outside, just take one over the middle, use that timeout to set up a field goal.
Only 12 seconds remaining now in the first half. Second and 10 from the 48. Ball on looking. Got some time. Now he's going to run it. No, he's going to be taken down. Jason Hill going to make the stop, and the clock's going to run out on the first half. It's halftime here in Baltimore. the studio now, and Mike Adamley. Okay, here we go. In 3, 2, 1. You are watching ESPN's coverage. ESPN, or we have a 2 on this. ESPN 2. So we got it. Here we go. In 3, 2, 1. You are watching ESPN 2's coverage of college football, where Georgia is taking on Vanderbilt in Nashville, Tennessee. Due to time constraints, we're moving ahead in our coverage.
You know, we don't have Hines, and we're really scrambling a little bit, but I'm happy with the way we're playing.
I'm sorry, Jim. 3, 2. I'm with Coach Jim Donnan. You score on defense, you score on offense, and you're pitching the shutout, yet you're not satisfied.
Well, you know, we've had a couple opportunities, but give Vanderbilt credit. They got a good defensive football team, but I've been pleased with our team. We're playing hard, playing enemy territory, and we just got to go out and finish it up.
Tell me a little bit about Mike Bobo. Assess what he's done the first half. A little heat.
Been very, you know, very good, but, you know, they've heated him up. They're trying to stop a running game, and it's hard to run when they got that many guys on the line, but we've hit enough big plays on them to get 20 points, so that's what we need.
All right, thank you very much. Good luck the second half. Coach Jim Donnan of Georgia playing without Hines Ward. They'd like to get away without playing their star senior player, and they're doing it. Back to you.
When I came to Vanderbilt, I knew the academic
crime. Back in Nashville, as we prepare to start the second half, Mike, at the top of the show, we talked about Mike Bobo and how he's made the difference for this team.
Boy, and he really has. Again, a lot more poise in the pocket this year as opposed to last year. We talked about the weight he lost. He wanted to be able to move a little bit more. And he's shown some great poise again in the pocket. Again, though, quick passes. They're kind of doing some swing passes, some quick passes to the receiver. Not really asking him to really carry the load. They're putting it on the wide receivers and the running backs and the offensive line. Again, how he's getting it done. Short passes, keeping the offensive lineman involved in the game. But he is taking some shots along the way. Vanderbilt's going to blitz him, and they're going to try and make him pay for every one of these passes. But he's getting them off, and he's throwing completions, even though he is taking a beating. I don't think Coach Jim Donnan's going to call any more options on him. Takes a little shot there from Jordan in the calf. They are just coming after him. But again, he's doing a nice job of getting rid of the ball. There he has some time. It'll hit the crossing tight end. He's getting knocked down. He's getting right back up and showing the course. I thought he was starting to feel it a little bit coming toward the end of the half. But again, these short passes really take a big chunk out of this Vanderbilt defense. Kind of frustrating him, say, listen, what can we do? We're getting to him. We're knocking him down, but they're still gaining yards. Running, and what they're doing, the big guys up front, give them credit. They are getting on the Vanderbilt linebackers. The strength of this defense, the Vanderbilt linebackers are just flat out getting blocked by the offensive line of Georgia. They're not used to having bodies on them.
John Dwyer had a chance to catch up with Jim Donnan, head coach from Georgia.
2. I'm with Coach Jim Donnan. You score on defense, you score on offense, and you're pitching the shutout, yet you're not satisfied.
Well, you know, we've had a couple opportunities, but give Vanderbilt credit. They got a good defensive football team, but I've been pleased with our team. We're playing hard, playing enemy territory, and we just got to go out and finish it up.
Tell me a little bit about Mike Bobo. Assess what he's done the first half. A little heat.
Been very, you know, very good, but, you know, they've heated him up. They're trying to stop the running game, and it's hard to run when they got that many guys on the line, but we've hit enough big plays on them to get 20 points, so that's what we need.
All right, thank you very much. Good luck the second half. Coach Jim Donnan of Georgia playing without Hines Ward. They'd like to get away without playing their star senior player, and they're doing it. Back to you.
Thanks a lot, John, for that interview with the coach. And saw the play with Damian Allen. Brinkett went off for 42 yards. That's not bad.
Now we're talking about big plays for Georgia and Mike Bobo. Well, Vanderbilt needs to put a few of these together. Damian Allen having some trouble with some accuracy. Well, let's use his legs a little bit.
Come on, Thunder's his way across the field. Check out the first half stats for this game. And there you look at the big advantages there for Georgia.
Well, huge. The thing is time of possession. I mean, again, this is putting Vanderbilt's defense, again, fourth ranked in the country, out on the field a long time. First downs, Georgia with 16 of them. They're running the ball very, very well. You see they hit a couple of big passes, but mainly it's been short passes with the wide receivers turning in the longer yards. But the big thing has been the running. Even though you only see 78 yards there, remember, Vanderbilt has only given up 98 per game. They got 78 and a half to Georgia.
Second and five from the Georgia 28. The pass out to the right. Can't hang on.
Vanderbilt is just doing enough not to be successful. This is the third drop we've seen tonight. As you see, Jared McGrath, another true freshman, wide open in the flat, got to make that play, would have had a first down. They like this kid, though, the thunder part of the thunder and lightning. They love running him up the middle. I don't think there's any choice here. I think they have to go for it. This is the third time they've been down fourth and short in their territory. One time they try to pooch punt. Another time they try to field goal. I don't think there's any doubt they're at the point where they have to go for it. Damien Allen, if they want him to throw the ball, well, he's just won for his last eight.
There you see. Fourth down conversions and offensive coordinator Ed Lambert. You thought they should have gone a couple of times in the first half.
Yeah, at least they're going now. I don't think there's any doubt now.
Fourth and three from the 26. Allen looks, throws, and completes it. Chuck Bailey on the stop, but the great catch by Todd Hilling
for Georgia.
First down for the Commodores.
And that one hurt. This is some very hard aftercare. He went up high. This is a 6'4" receiver, Sam. What you do with him is you throw it up high. Make him go up, use a 6'5" frame up high, and he lands hard on his hip and on his back. And this is some very hard turf. He had to go out of the game, catch his breath. But, hey, the big thing, first down. Vanderbilt, the deepest penetration they've had the whole game.
First and 10 from the 28 Georgia. Defensive pursuit.
If Vanderbilt can score here, they can still keep their game plans, and they can still keep it together if they're down 20-7. That gives them time to still work the running in with the passing. They've got to come away with some points here. Three would be okay. I mean, at least they're going to get on the ball. That's a pretty good confidence builder they really could use to get in the end zone. Well, that's the fourth drop of the night we've seen. Again, had him in the hands, even though he had to reach for it, and he would have fell even when he caught it. Got to make that play. Ronald Bailey, one of the Bailey brothers in the coverage, was actually backing away from it. Carson would have had a little bit of room to run if he could have stayed on his feet, but he's got to catch that ball first.
Here's what they've done on third down tonight. They need to convert here. Third and 7 from the 17.
Quarter in Nashville.
Woody.
Can we see that again?
What is it called?
It's one of the ugliest things I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah. Go ahead and kick it.
You know? Yeah, I don't know why they want to go do that.
Come out of the locker room and you drive in.
Bill Maskell. That's who he was, John with the special team.
ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by BMW, the ultimate driving machine.
Back at Vanderbilt, Sam Crenshaw along with Mike Golick and John Dwyer, and the Commodores have just gotten on the board. 20-6 now the score in the third quarter. Back to receive for Georgia. Pass and Bailey. Looks like it will come down to Bailey. Stop.
Go back and take a look at the touchdown for Vanderbilt. Again, the blitz. Damian Allen does a nice job reading it. Morgan, a good job of just going right where the linebacker left. Greg Bright blitzed. Morgan just took his spot. Ran right where he was. Damian Allen, nice job getting it to him. And then Morgan, the bulldozer. I love this guy's blocking abilities. So you know if he's a good blocker, he can get it in the end zone. Bill Maskell, the special team coach, with Woody Widerhofer there talking about that botched extra point. I don't know why they just didn't kick it.
You think they would. Georgia with a great return, 46 yards. First and 10 from the 46. Edwards across midfield. Inside Vanderbilt territory.
Tackle made by
down to the 47.
And this is something that the Vanderbilt defense is not used to. Again, they gave up 78 yards rushing in the first half. Robert Edwards with the carry there. They've only given up 98 yards a game. We give a lot of credit to that offensive line. Chris Terry, Antonio Fleming, Brad Stafford, Kenley Ingram, and Matt Stinson, because they are opening holes for these running backs.
9 carries, 35 yards, 300, second and 4, Georgia. He stopped by Anthony Jordan.
Georgia's going to keep trying to control the ball. Then they had it 17 minutes the first half. See, the first 6 games, 98 yards, 85 already tonight. Georgia doing a great job. You know, when that run is successful, it opens that passing game. But with Georgia, it's almost in reverse, Sam, as we talked about. You know how their passing game is really opening up the run.
And look at an animated Norm Parker, the defensive coordinator for Vanderbilt. 3rd and 3 from the 47 of Vanderbilt. Helps trip him up, but it's a first down for Georgia.
This is confidence in your running game. It's 3rd and 3, sometimes a short passing situation. Look at that offensive line. Little trap pulled by Antonio Fleming. A nice job, body on body. And that's the key thing they're doing. They're not really blowing anybody off the line of scrimmage. They're getting body on body. And with these defensive linemen, it's not a big defensive line or linebackers. They have a tough time getting off.
1st and 10 from the 40 of Vanderbilt.
Happened to tonight, and they changed a lot of plays tonight. They've done a nice job of audibilizing.
They have a dead ball foul. delay of the game against the offense, violation of the 25-second play clock, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Well, it's first and 15, but Georgia has been averaging 8 yards on every first down play, so
Georgia Bulldogs
every yard of that this time.
Number 36, Michael Greer, checks back into the lineup for Georgia. He has a touchdown reception in the first half. So it's first and 15 now from the 45 of Vanderbilt. Small, the junior from Jacksonville, Florida.
And you're right, Fred Vinson did have great coverage, but he didn't turn around when the ball was being thrown. Good touch by Bobo, again taking a shot. He's taking a lot of hits. Smalls is the guy. He is the receiver tonight with Hines Ward out. Vinson, the mistake you made, Sam, he doesn't look back for the ball. You've got to look at the wide receiver. When you see his eyes and his hands going up, you know the ball is coming. You've got to turn and make a play on it.
Small out at 7 catches, 83 yards. The give is the pass is knocked down. The ball comes loose. Ainsley Battles comes away with the football, but the officials say it's still Georgia's ball.
You want to talk about the perfect blitz to take on an offensive play. This is a counter running play. Back to the weak side, to the short side of the field, and Vanderbilt had two guys blitzing from the short side of the field. This had no chance, and that was a fumble.
Yes, it was.
That was a fumble.
Yes, it was.
I think the referees just naturally thought that him hitting the ground caused that fumble. And Vanderbilt can use every break they can get. They lost out on one, man.
Instead, Georgia gets the ball. Second and 14 from the 29. Corey Chavis. We talked about Corey Chavis, man. He's got a little football in his blood. Had an uncle to play professional football.
14 years with Denver.
Yep.
Uncle Raymond, but nicknamed Barney. Figure that one out.
Yep. With the Broncos.
Corey Chavis, great coverage. And he had a touchdown pass thrown on him, but again, he had great coverage on that. Here's a guy that's 203 pounds, so he's a good-sized guy playing corner. Normally you see your cornerbacks 185, 180 pounds. He's over 200 pounds playing corner. Again, you will see him play on Sundays.
Third down once again for Georgia. They're 7-10 on conversions so far tonight. Third and 14 from the 29. Better with the pass. Small can't get it, but we got a flag around the 28. Corey Chavis was there again on the scene.
Again, these are two of the least penalized teams in the Southeast Conference, and Vandy just cost himself again. Give Georgia another shot with an offside. Probably somebody obviously lined up offsides. Giving them too many chances. Again, they're doing just enough to not be successful. A breakdown here, a breakdown there, and then they're getting hurt. Again, not a lot of penalties for Vanderbilt, but very bad timing on their penalties.
Third and 9 for Georgia. Orlandis Gary, 22 in the backfield alongside Mike Bobo. Here comes the pressure. Bobo goes down as Bellman comes up. That is Gary's goal, but what a shot on Mike Bobo. Ainsley Battles. Came through untouched.
Another flag down, though. Let's see if Georgia's going to get another shot. They don't. It's holding on Georgia. They'll decline it. Take the sack. Mike Bobo has got to see that blitz coming. He's got to see.
And look at Bobo right now.
He is hurt. He is taking a beating tonight. Give him credit for hanging in there. But he had to see Ainsley Battles coming up. He's got to have that peripheral vision and see him before the snap, knowing he's going to come. He's got to know he's got to get the ball off. Because Battles started giving it away early. He was walking to the line. Bobo's got to see that before the snap, so he knows he has to get rid of the ball.
On to try the field goal attempt. Half Hines already has two tonight. This one will be from 49.
Hands around his goal in the field goal. Season was 32.
At the 39, a 49-yard attempt.
And that will make it.
run came from the outside. He tried to hold up and lost his balance.
We had running into the kicker against the defense. 5-yard penalty. Still fourth down.
Now again, it's just like a punt. If it's roughing the punter or the field goal kicker, it's 5 yards. If it's a personal foul and they do it, then it's 15 and a first down. You see, he just kind of loses his balance there at the end, and his feet catches half Hines, and Hines does a nice job doing a little acting.
Yeah.
Going down and saying, hey, you really hit me. Throw the flag. It worked, they threw it, so they move it up 5 yards and get another crack at it.
Just a touch of Hollywood. Let's see what happens now. Fourth and 11.
Looks like they're going to go for it.
They're going to go for it. Fourth and 11 from the 27.
Interesting call. Again, they moved it up 5. It would be about a 43-yard attempt. Again, coming into the game, Pat Hines had kicked along the 32.
Now the officials are in conference.
Graphic about there were 7 different receivers that caught a pass and 6 different people that have run the ball. I don't know if that's something you want to come back showing or if you want to wait till they have the ball again. Okay. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, you had that. That's absolutely right.
We also got some info here on Bobo. I don't know when you want us to work it in. About him now moving into the number 2 spot.
For attempts?
For Georgia passing yards.
Yeah, oh, okay.
Topping the old Zeker.
Zeke Brekowski.
Tennessee 38, Alabama 21. That's a final. ACC, Missouri 37-29
victory over Texas, and Colorado 42-6 over Kansas. Ohio Valley Conference action today. Eastern Kentucky 29-8 over Murray State. Tennessee Tech 33-2 over Tennessee Martin. And Eastern Illinois 30 over Tennessee. Okay. 17. Back to Nashville, and a look at a frustrated Woody Woodenhopper, whose defense was doing all the right things, but then this play has to be the crucial one in the drive.
Absolutely. Vanderbilt kept Georgia in the drive with penalties, but the referees missed a call there. That was clearly a fumble that would have gave Vanderbilt the ball. Well, on 4th and 10, after the roughing the kicker, they go for it. Nice pass to Greer. Battles gets turned around, and he's in for the easy touchdown. That's Greer's 2nd of the night.
impressed with Bobo. He's hanging in there. He has taken a beating tonight.
Yes, he is.
And I thought for a while at the end of the half he was kind of backing out, but he is really, really hanging in the pocket. That's a happy young man. He's gonna have to ice down on the plane ride home, but it's always nice to ice down after a win than a loss. It hurts a little more with a loss.
So much better when it's on a win. First and 10, Vanderbilt for their own 28. Let's go downstairs and check in with John Dwyer.
Two subjects quickly. Vanderbilt going for two. I went up and down the Vanderbilt bench to a player and a staff member. Nobody knows why. My thinking is you need at least three touchdowns, so perhaps they are trying an element of surprise. That didn't work. As far as the fourth and 10 going for it, Vandy fans not happy about it, thinking they're running up the score. Well, Hap Hines actually injured his plant foot during the field goal try that had the penalty. Therefore, he couldn't go.
That's McGrath on the run. Trey Sipe on the stop for Georgia.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good reason to go for it. Your kicker's plant foot is hurt a little bit. And running up the score, you know, it's 20-6. That's still two scores away from a tie ball game with 6 minutes to go in the third quarter. They're not at the point yet of running up the score. They needed to get that score to get themselves a little farther ahead of Vandy. That's not running up the score at all.
And that's coming back after a successful Vanderbilt drive.
Yeah, they had about 3 seconds left on the play clock. They would have got penalized, and they got a third and three and a first down they need.
First down round of the second half.
It's a win-win opportunity.
And third and three is actually good for Vanderbilt. The first half, they were averaging 39. Every third down, they normally had 9 yards to go, so third and three is pretty good for them.
Georgia with the lead at 27-6. We'll be right back to Nashville. Okay. At Nashville, Tennessee, and Mike Bobo, quarterback for Georgia. He's taking some shots, but he's got his team out front.
Yeah, you'll take the shots when you're throwing touchdown passes. Vandy here on third and three. They're 2-8 on third down conversions, but this third and three, the shortest amount of yards they've had to go on any third down tonight. Let's see if they're successful. From their own 35.
Ausma with the catch. Jeff Harris with a stop for Georgia.
That was an impressive throw, but boy, Jeff Harris come over and laid a pop on to Asmar. Let's check out the hit. It's a nice tackle, one you dream about when they're not looking at you.
That's Asmar's first catch of the night, a 10-yard pickup, first and 10 from the home 45. Allen, the fish.
Jaron McGrath to midfield for the Commodores.
The senior from Moultrie, Georgia.
Tampa Bay Bay number 45, Greg Bright.
That was McGrath on the outside. He normally runs inside the Thunder part of Thunder and Lightning with five. Williams, the other second freshman, down. Being the outside guy. This, he has to pitch it quick and get some quick pressure on him. McGrath, you see his power. He runs into Greg Bright, and he runs over Greg Bright. Now, this is the guy who was one of the on the watch list for the Butkus Award, and Greg Bright, the linebacker. McGrath, the true freshman, said, I don't care.
Bright had 12 tackles last week against Tennessee. Big play man indeed. Second and five for midfield.
Doing something he did for a while and wasn't real comfortable with is pure pocket passing. These last couple of passes, he's just been standing in the pocket and zipping the ball. He's got a good, hard ball. He's been accurate with it. You see the bobble there for a moment, but he came down with it because he's seen a few drops.
And that was almost taken away by Champ Bailey.
And that time, Damian Allen just flat out threw it to the wrong guy. There was double coverage deep. Anthony Asma was wide open running across the field. He threw it into two deep coverage deep down the field and got lucky it wasn't picked off. As you see there, about 10 yards in front of you running across the field was Anthony Asma with nobody on him.
Second and 10.
Well, even though they're down 27-6, they're still mixing up the play call. Great job of running by Allen. Everybody knows he's a good running track. Watch his cutting ability. Cuts back once, cuts back again, takes out, comes back the other way, does a nice job of moving and still getting the first down. Always good to add that extra threat of the quarterback running.
Six times, 44 yards.
Just when you sing his praises, maybe we shouldn't do that. But it jinxed them. Running the option out, it's been successful, so they keep going with it. Just a bad pitch on the part of Damian Allen. Tried to lead McGrath, just let him way too much.
Loss of six on the play.
And when you're a struggling offense, second and 16 is not good. Offensive coordinator Ed Lambert knows that. Ed Lambert, interesting story. He wants to be a head coach. In college, he has no thought at all. He was actually a possibility of him coaching in the NFL with Kevin Gilbride in San Diego, wanted no part of it. Said he wants to be a college head coach, said he wants to be the first African-American head college football coach to win a national title.
We'll keep an eye out for it. Let's take a look at the BMW storyline so far from the game here tonight. There you see the score. Bailey running in, the 10-yard fumble recovery to get Georgia on the board. Michael Greer in with the two touchdown catches. That's big with Ward on the sideline tonight. Bobo having another big night in spite of being nailed on a number of times.
Yeah, he's leading this offense. There's no doubt. Again, he came in the best completion percentage in the SEC, number four in the country. His QB rating is like 166. He's throwing well. Again, they're not asking him to throw very hard passes, but the bottom line is he's getting the job done. He's spread the ball out. Seven different receivers tonight have caught a ball, and he knows how to move the ball around. He's just has a lot more poise than last year when he threw 16 interceptions. This year, just two. His touchdown to interception ratio is very, that's probably one of the biggest stats that kind of gets shuffled and hidden behind them, but that's a very big stat when you figure out the quarterback rating system.
Second and 16 from the 38 of Georgia. Let's see what Dan Lambert has cooked up. And the Commodores can continue this drive.
To Anthony Asma.
Larry Mann in on the stop for Georgia.
Well, now I don't want to be overly critical about this. It was a nice throw, a nice reception. But the key thing you want to do here is lead your receiver. He leads him. It's 6 points. He throws up high and behind him. He isn't able to keep his balance, and he falls down. Beat him a little more. I guess I'm being a little too picky.
Yeah.
Like to see the kids succeed.
Great catch by Asper, though, to be able to come back and get down. First and 10 from the 15 of Georgia.
That's the second one we've seen McGrath drop now. Both in the flat like that. Has trouble with both of them.
Is that okay?
Trey Sipe on the coverage. Another one he should have had. That's the fifth drop pass we've seen tonight. You know, we talk about Damian Allen. Sometimes his accuracy a little bit off. It's been on pretty well tonight. He's done
really has.
Throws the ball hard, but he gets it sort of where it needs to be. And the guys are having a hard time catching the ball tonight.
11th play of this drive coming up. Second and 10 from the 15. Throwing. Complete. What a touchdown. Jimmy Williams.
To the call a little bit for Vanderbilt. You see Jimmy Williams, two freshmen excited. Little misdirection play. When we get to take a look at it, they fake the run. Jimmy Williams kind of took his time getting out there, but a good job by the line. Again, any misdirection play action pass, the quarterback's got to have time.
Red Spoon from the point after. It's good. They kick it this time.
No questions. Here you're going to see the fake. Jimmy Williams goes up like he's going to block and then just kind of strolls on out. Everybody following Damian Allen because they've seen him do the half roll to his right a lot tonight. So the defensive backs start to roll with him. Jimmy Williams does a nice job disguising. He stayed in there to block for a second. Then he just kind of took his time getting to the outside. Nobody picks him up.
And Allen's pretty pumped up. Second successful drive for him tonight.
Well, they're keeping him in it. You know, 304 in the third. Now, we've got to rely on the Vanderbilt defense that's been relied on all year long. Needs to come up with a stop. So far, they have not really answered the bell tonight, Sam. They've given up 27 points to Georgia. Woody Woodenhofer is a defense, again, 11 years as a defensive coordinator with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Guys like Jack Lambert, Mean Joe Green, Jack Hamm, Andy Russell. He's playing that same thing. You'll see the nose tackle and his defense tilted. Reason for that, you try and heat up the center and the guard, freeing up your linebackers. Hasn't been too successful tonight. The offensive line for Georgia able to get off on this tackle.
Bailey and pass back to receive the kickoff. Bailey takes it away. He's up across the 50. Hit around the 16. Big stop by Jason Dada.
You know, in the first quarter, I talked about an important drive for the Vanderbilt defense that they needed to make a stop. They didn't. Georgia went down and scored. Here again, with 2:53 left in the third, this could be a momentum changer right here at the Vandy defense, led by defensive coordinator Norm Parker there, to come up with a stop.
And Georgia in on that play.
Well, Georgia, one thing they can't do is go away from what's been successful for them. Right now, it looks like they're cocooning a bit. They're just going to try and run the straight-ahead plays, the straight-ahead passes and runs. They need to be diverse like they've been throughout the whole game. That gave them these 27 points. No time to go into a shell.
Pass coming out. Orlandis Gary in the lineup in the backfield for Georgia now. Along with Robert Evans. Second and 10 from their own 16. Play clock runs out.
a dead ball foul, the way of the game against the offense.
That's the second time that's happened. And give credit to the Vanderbilt defense. What they do is they step in the gaps. They move the quarterbacks and the safeties, move up a little bit. And when that happens, Mike Bobo sees it, so he'll audible. He tried to audible again, but when you do that, that takes up a little bit of time. The Vandy defense does a nice job of disguising, trying to fake what they're going to do.
Less than 2 minutes to go here in the third quarter. It's second and 15 from the 11 for Georgia.
We talked about him, 245-pounder on the nose. This was a double team. Look at him. The center's got him. The guard coming back trying to get him. He breaks through both of them to make the play. I asked Noah Parker, this guy's 245-pounds. He's playing in the middle of the field. They said, listen, hey, there's a street fight. You want this guy on your side. He'll throw some wheelhouses, roundhouses. He'll kick, scratch, and fight. And that's exactly what he did. Nice dude, too. That's exactly what he did to get the shot.
Throw the 25 from the 1. Quick pass to Edwards, and he stopped. Another stop for Vanderbilt.
That was the first third and out for Georgia, or for Vanderbilt defense all night tonight. Norm Parker's got to be happy with his crew there. Again, this is what worked early, the quick passes. Vanderbilt playing a little closer to the vest. Again, Popo taking another shot. She's almost into the pole.
That's tough.
And now, watch they may come after this punt. The punter doesn't get the full 15 yards to hang back. He's only back about 12.
That's one swing from the back of his arm. Got a whistle.
When they shifted, when the line shifted for Vanderbilt, one of the Georgia people moved. It's going to put him back another yard.
We have a dead ball foul. False start against the offense. Moving in the line. Half the distance of the goal. Still fourth down.
Yards may not seem like a lot here, but for a punter who's normally back, and remember, the punter's normally back 15 yards from the snapper to give him room to kick. Now, they're on the 1 yard line. He can only be back 11 yards with his heels on the end zone line.
That's Dax Langley.
They got to be coming after him.
4 seconds, 3 seconds, 2 seconds, and that's the end of the third quarter. There is 5 seconds left on the play clock. We will see what happens when we come back to start the fourth quarter. Georgia leading 27-13 here in Nashville. Really, no
there's,
win.
There's no win.
All the flags are limp.
No, there's no win.
There's no win.
Good halftime adjustments by Vanderbilt.
Yeah, yeah. I just need some more of this, man. Yeah, I just give me another cup. You're going to get that. Yeah.
What do you want to come back with, Greg? Defensively or offensively? Anything?
Corral's fought back to lead the team in tackles and earned freshman All-SEC honors in 1990. Following his Vanderbilt career, he was told he didn't have the size to make it in the NFL. Today,
do you want to come back, Greg, maybe come back with a shot of the special team coach? Before? Yeah, Bill Malico? He's in the huddle. There you go.
Once again, Daniel Commodore would like to thank Denny's for providing the promotional football provided for the game tonight. Stop by Denny's.
He dressed out to warm up, but once he couldn't go.
Yeah, he changed.
Thank you.
Tennessee, Sam Pritchard, along with Mike Bennett, and a big fourth down play.
Special team coach Bill Masco, there's two trains of thought, go for the block, or set up for return.
That's right. Gets it away. Six-yard return. Champ Bailey there for the stop.
That's a good special team play by Georgia to get the ball out, get a 40-yard punt, and get down there and cover for only a six-yard return. Champ Bailey getting down there to make the tackle. We've seen him a cornerback, wide receiver, punt coverage. When you got a great athlete, you use him.
All over the field. First and 10 from the 34 of Georgia. That was a great opportunity.
Damian Allen has got to be so frustrated. He's throwing the ball well. That's a second drop for Elliot Carson tonight, and the sixth or seventh overall. Again, he throws the ball hard, but you know what? They practice with that. They've got to be used to the fact that he throws the ball hard. He's throwing it a little high, but you've got to catch that ball.
For all the things we've heard about Allen and his problems he had this season, you got to give him credit. He's doing some of the right things tonight.
He sure is. He's hitting the right guys on a 9 out of 10 percent.
Brandon Tobin. Let's go downstairs and check in with John Dwyer.
Damian Allen is a senior and he only has a few more games to play, but he is throwing with more confidence than he has played all season. This is the Damian Allen that Woody Woodenhofer has been looking for. In the loss to LSU, Damian was tentative. Here he is a controlled leader. This is what Vandy football has been waiting for.
The option has been successful. That try, they tried to the short side of the field. You run out of territory real quick when you go to that side. Gutsy call by Ed Lambert. I don't think there's any doubt they have to go here. Again, you see they're on the left hand. Just too many white shirts over there to make the pitch. If he'd made the pitch, they're out of real estate, running out of bounds.
Fourth down coming up. Fourth and 8.
They better hurry. There's 10 seconds. They're just breaking the huddle.
Play clock winding down. 4 seconds. They get it off. Allen looking. Still time. Throwing it up there. And the receiver was out of bounds. Pulled in by Jimmy Williams, but he was already out of bounds. Ball goes over to Georgia.
Give some credit to number 58 for Georgia, Aranis Grant, for a nice job putting pressure.
Still a missed opportunity for Vanderbilt. Georgia will have the ball when we come back to the Music City.
I think that was a horrible call. That was a, the guy's actually throwing the ball pretty good. And then you run it to the short side of the field? God, I don't think his future, I don't think him and Woody are going to get along too well.
Nah, making calls like that.
Man.
Icy, not tonight.
All right, okay, yeah, yeah.
You have a special event on the airport transportation.
Woody don't look too happy.
No, he doesn't.
Ooh. Yes.
The team's hanging tough. There seems to be the tension among the ranks.
Now
the
he's
coaches.
Talking with Bill Masco, the special team coach, who felt Woody's wrath a little earlier. Yeah. Misery loves company, huh?
ESPN2's presentation of college football is brought to you by Honda. Vehicles designed to help simplify your life.
Back here at Nashville, and a bit of conversation among the coaching staff, Mike, after that third down play was called for Vanderbilt.
Well, after they didn't get that fourth down play, this was a conversation between head coach Woody Woodenhofer and offensive coordinator Ed Lambert. Ed trying to explain, I believe, the option play he called. Woody doesn't look too enthusiastic about the explanation. Woody has already butted heads with Bill Masco, the special team coach, after the botched two-point conversion after the first Vanderbilt touchdown. He's a guy that he'll let you know if he's displeased with what's going on. And right now, I think he's displeased with a few calls that are going on.
Second and six for Georgia from the all 36.
Half in this game, gave up a lot of points to Georgia, put themselves in a hole. Here you see Ryan Alls on the nose again, does a great job doing a swim move on Brad Staff at the center. Edwards has to cut back, great pursuit on the outside. Carlton Hall there, number 34, and Alls and his friends able to make the bring down. This is the type of defense Vanderbilt was playing all year, not what you saw in the first half, but it cost him in the first half.
Still, Bailey comes away with a great catch.
Well, these are two of the best athletes on the field tonight. Corey Chavis and Bailey. And Champ Bailey, obviously Bailey, you see him on defense and offense. Got time, nice throw. Next time he doesn't get hit. See, Chavis is there, beaten by just a step. Again, he doesn't look back, but right at the end he does. Almost gets his hands on it. Great concentration by Champ Bailey.
First and 10 for Georgia.
Great athlete, only a sophomore.
28 of Vanderbilt got a whistle and a timeout.
They got to burn another one. The play clock is down to three.
While they go to break, we will too. 11:37 left. Georgia leads it 27-13.
They need to be back.
Hey, we're gonna get the Georgia dog at all, or stuff,
yeah, man,
stuff like that.
We gotta show up.
Okay.
Is this the baseball game over? Can I mention the Patrick passes in the Marlins farm system?
Yeah,
I don't want to mention it until the game's over. Okay.
Okay.
There he is.
Are we going to go to John or just go to... Okay.
He's doing just like his dad.
Sonny.
He's doing just like his dad used to do. Every time you put a camera down in front of him, he turns around. Come on. Back in Nashville, Tennessee, Uga 5, the mascot for the Georgia Bulldogs. He has to be enjoying what he's seeing tonight. His favorite team's leading. ABC presenting college football package that you can't duplicate. ESPN game plan for $11.95. You'll see up to 10 great college football games on Saturday, not on TV in your area. Don't wait to subscribe today. Call your local cable operator or go to TV. 6-10 Georgia from a 28 of Vanderbilt. One of the players who came from Marshall along with Jim Dunning to play on this Georgia football team.
Ugga had, had a dad. Ugga 5 had a dad.
Had a pretty good record. Went to a bowl game each and every year. Ugga 4 did.
So Ugga 5 got some big paws to throw, huh?
Yes, he does. 7-5. From the 23. He gets to go. He's at the 20. 15.
Well, Ugga's happy. He'll get his milk bones later. All he's happy about. He's seen it so many times, yeah. He's
emotional. What's up, Black? At the crib. What's up, baby?
You can almost see.
Georgia, baby, number one.
You can almost see the ebb and flow of this game. You saw the Vanderbilt defense really gain the momentum. Start to hammer some people. Start to stop Georgia. Georgia hits the big play. You can almost feel the air and see the air go out of that Vanderbilt defense. They had been stuffing Georgia this whole second half. They come up with a big play, and all of a sudden, Georgia hits that running game again on them.
23-yard touchdown play. The Georgia center, Brad Stafford, being helped off the field, got injured on that play.
Part of a group that's had a good game tonight for Georgia, that offensive line, the unsung heroes, the guys that do the down and dirty work, they have really done a great job tonight.
Hap Hines on for the point after.
It is good.
And Georgia's lead goes to 34-13. Another look at the touchdown by Gary.
Nothing fancy, right up the gut. He just cuts it back again. The wind, I really think, went out of the sails of Vanderbilt. Weren't as aggressive on that play. A lot of credit to Orlandis Gary. A great job of cutting back. They're over 100 yards rushing tonight, and that hasn't happened to a Vandy defense very much. Good job of sight and vision of cutting it back.
Molly Green Hills, as unique as you are.
And for the touchdown, again, as you said, came over with Jim Donovan from Marshall.
There's a look at the drive, a short one this time. Only 2:57 off the clock, five plays. Of course, that big, big play to Champ Bailey. Let's check in now with John Dwyer on the sideline.
And Ugga 5 looks the other way. Other way, this is family viewing. We're with Sonny Siler. Sonny, you own Ugga 5. You've been doing this since 1956. You're out of Savannah, Georgia. Good year for Ugga, named the best mascot by a national publication. Also, a movie star, huh?
All of that.
The movie comes out in November, directed by Clint Eastwood, filmed in Savannah. What's the name of it?
You've done your homework, John. It's Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, and it premieres on November the 20th.
Is he a good dog or a bad dog in this?
Well, he's a good dog in anything, but he's a reasonably good actor in the movie. He's a better mascot.
As a mascot, he's a pretty good actor. We appreciate your time.
Georgia
has a pretty good agent.
Picked up by Lyman D.
On the return, Alvin Duke from Vanderbilt gets it up to around the 20-yard line. Ugga's got things going great, huh?
Ugga found himself in Sports Illustrated, voted the best mascot, a movie. I mean, that's, boy, you know, the next Lassie.
Might be Ugga.
Gets treated pretty good, though, doesn't he?
He gets treated really good. He lives in Savannah, comes up to the games in Athens. They put him up in a hotel room.
He sleeps in a bed.
As a matter of fact, his father, Ugga 4, back during the 80s, his father fell out of the bed and broke a leg. And they still brought him to the game. They wheeled him out there. Champ Bailey on the coverage. He was looking for Hogan.
You know, that's one of the few passes by Damian Allen tonight that was really off the mark. He has thrown relatively well tonight for the type of season he had been having. He really was playing pretty well tonight. Had a lot of drop balls. That pass nowhere near the mark, though.
10:27 remaining in the game. Second and 10 from the 20. Dustin Lucky, one of three Luckies.
Yeah, how about that
on this team?
Yeah, we talked about the Bailey brothers. We got something else for you. Another brother. Can't even say Canada.
Third and five. We should take a look at Lucky. Number 26. First down.
Well, we talked about
the Bailey brothers, the Champ, the slew of brothers.
Also on Georgia, triplets. The Lucky brothers, Dustin, Mike, and Miles. Two backup linebackers and a backup center. Wow.
He's trying once again for Fred Baker. I guess you could say Mama Lucky is real lucky to have Georgia paying the grocery bills.
You're not kidding, because you got to know her grocery bills. Imagine the dinner table there. I'll tell you what, when the food ran out, some angry kids. I wonder if they pull any pranks, you know, like each other's classes.
Oh, you could imagine.
That whole thing, yeah?
You could imagine. But these guys are probably not growing up. For Georgia.
Boy, outside of reverses and Statue of Liberty plays and all those other grab back plays, the array of plays Vanderbilt has called tonight has been pretty good. They've really mixed it up a lot with half rolls, drop back, straight drop back options, you know, a screen pass, quarterback draw. They've really mixed it up well.
But comes in and makes a big hit there.
That's on Allen's blind side. He never saw it coming. Just flat out beat Clay Condrey, the left tackle. Oh, that's a blind side. Those are tough when the quarterback doesn't know he's coming. His body's relaxed, and they get that whiplash effect.
Big hit by the junior from Bradenton, Florida.
Tension is breaking down a bit for Damien Allen. That was an inside stunt, and Michael Saltzman didn't pick it up. It came over too late. Brandon Miller, number 51, able to make the penetration. Good stunt in the middle between the two tackles. You take a beating in the middle there. Every now and then it's nice to throw in a stunt so the same guy doesn't keep pounding over and over again. And it's like it worked there, confuse the offensive lineman who normally just try and switch to the next man. Weren't able to do that.
Got a whistle now, and a timeout by Vanderbilt. And we'll take 1-2. 9 minutes remaining here from Nashville, Georgia, in charge of this one.
Hey, Greg, next time Georgia has the ball, if you want to get a picture of Hines Ward and no clothes on the sideline, we'll talk about him some if you want.
No clothes?
No. Well, if he's no clothes, that'd be even better. Why is Hines Ward naked on the sideline?
Well, that's the reason why you see the schedule they got coming up.
Yep, exactly, you know? Right.
They can afford to hold him out. Why not? Doesn't do much for him trying to catch up with that quadruple 1,000 yards.
Yep. Hey, hey, Greg, when you're going to show him maybe when Georgia has the ball, have to back up with it. The rest of Georgia's schedule. if you could, and then we're going to tie that in as one of the reasons he's sitting out tonight. Okay. Okay.
You all right back there?
Oh, yeah.
All right. Okay. Oh, all right. Stepped up tonight in the absence of Hines Ward.
That's been big. That's been real big. Tony Small having a big night. Actually, seven different receivers have caught passes tonight. You get your big gun out, you have to rely on other people. Tony Small came up with a number of catches, but Mike Bobo, a nice job around of spreading it to seven different receivers. Small's number, seven receptions for 83 yards by himself.
Let's check in now with John Dwyer on the sideline.
I'm with a guy that didn't play it down, but he's happy as anybody. Senior wide receiver, Hines Ward. Hines, the knee just wasn't worth testing, right?
Yeah, especially on this AstroTurf. You know, Coach Donna felt like, you know, there really wasn't no need to use me today. And he just wanted to save me in the long run. You know, we got Kentucky next week and Florida the week after, so it's better for me not to play today.
With the sprained left knee, if you had to go, if you did not get the 10-0 lead, would you have gone in?
I mean, I felt good, but, you know, I felt like I can go today, but, you know, we got up to a lead, so I felt like I didn't have to go today.
You have played just about every position but center and assistant coach on offense through your years. You fought through some adversity. Is this sweet now that you're on a winning program? Perhaps good things are ahead.
Oh, yes, most definitely, you know, especially coming back from my senior year to come out, you know, if we get this victory tonight, we'll be 5-1. So we're looking pretty good this year. And, you know, a lot of seniors this year took it upon themselves to go out and win, go out on the winning note this year. That's what we're trying to do.
All right, you're going to be healthy next week?
Yeah, most definitely.
Hines Ward, a smile on his face, and he doesn't even have to take a shower.
Take a look at the remaining schedule for Georgia. Like Hines Ward said, he can afford to lay out tonight.
Well, exactly. The AstroTurf is a big reason. This is a very hard turf, but look at this. Look at this schedule. Kentucky, Florida, Auburn, Mississippi. Pulled off a nice upset of LSU today and finished up with Georgia Tech. They're going to need this guy healthy. You know, down the road, I talked to Jim Donner before the game. He said, yeah, we'd like to use him tonight because every time he's in there, we got a great shot of winning, but we got a lot of other games we got to win. I'd rather have him healthy to play more games than risk him trying to win this game and get him hurt even more.
First and 10 for Georgia. You know, Mike, you talked about the artificial surface, and this is the final remaining artificial surface in the Southeastern Conference. At one time, it was very prevalent in this conference. Alabama, Ole Miss, Florida, Legion Field in Birmingham, they've all gone back to the natural stuff.
Well, everybody got smart. They started realizing, yeah, it's less costly to maintain, but when people you're counting on are laying in the rehab table with busted up knees,
Ryan Alls still playing.
Robert Edwards on the carry.
That's your man. You like him.
I'll tell you what, you're 245.
Ryan Alls makes a tackle.
A redshirt freshman, you can stick it right in the middle of the field. I mean, when you're a nose tackle, my brother Bob said it, played 14 years in the NFL, he said it's kind of like being a fire hydrant. You know? Everybody's taking a shot at you.
Yeah, yeah.
You're getting hit from all sides, and he does a nice job, and he'll put on some weight. He's got a few years on. He'll put on some weight, but he made what he
did.
That's the third time it's happened tonight. Is that something to be concerned about?
Well, and I was going to say tonight and right now, they won't. But when Jim Donnan looks at the film, sees the mistakes, it's something you bring up and you say, listen, guys, you know, this is going to cost us. There's going to be a game where it's 7-6, where it's 10-7, where it's close, where we can't make these mistakes. You know, we can't cost us 5 yards, or we can't burn a timeout. Tonight, it's not going to affect it, so you're not going to really see anybody get upset. But you know, Jim Donnan, a very disciplined coach, will talk to the team about it.
That makes it 3rd and 9 now from their own 44. Is England to Edwards. Picks up about 4, maybe 3. Carlton Hall still in there fighting away, making the stop for Vanderbilt. Downstairs now to John Dwyer.
Sam, Mike Bobo has a Bobo. He is icing his left shoulder and his left elbow. He actually heard it during the first quarter, and he says, hey, it's this AstroTurf. So, Mike Golic, you got another vote to tear this thing up, but he's going to be all right. He'll be all right next week.
Thanks a lot, Jack.
It's like a pitcher after a big game icing down the shoulder and the elbow.
Six-yard return. Uga likes it. We'll be back to Nashville.
Maybe Hollenshead makes the tackle.
Okay.
These are the who players of the game. These are sponsored, aren't they?
Is this sponsored? National Car?
National Car, okay. National Car rental player.
Well, we have this break in the action, which reminds you that Subway Sandwiches at the Park Place Shopping Center.
Yeah. Yeah, we have about
252. Fresh. Just a taste. Green Hills.
Showing you his good side.
And there he goes.
Feels like his dad.
Okay, he's still in? Damien's still in?
It's a great commercial.
Yeah.
Can you run that commercial again?
Yeah. Back in Nashville, Tennessee, Georgia leading at 34-13, 4:23 remaining. Take a look at our National Car Rentals players of the game, right?
Mike Bobo did a great job, got banged around, stood in the pocket, threw well, a lot of poise. Damien Allen, you see the numbers, 15-34, at least 7 drops.
Dustin Lucky in with the sack.
O.J. Fleming hanging out of the ball that time. Came in as a wide receiver. He's added 40 pounds since he's been here. Get him up to 261 now, tight end.
Big pressure on number 38, Antonio Cochran.
Nice move by Cochran.
NHL tonight. All your scores and highlights from action.